one. You are live, you are live.
Morning, morning, morning. And we are on the most incredible sunrise safari. It is beautiful out here this morning. It's about 24 degrees Celsius, so just over 70 Fahrenheit. There's not a cloud in the sky. And we have the most stunning sunrise on the way. My name is Brent Leo-Smith. I have Dangerous Dave on camera. We have Jandre and Jamie on the other camera. And we have Geraldine and Louise in final control. Now, Mr. Tingana basically walked through camp last night, and I'm sure the Juma Cam aficionados would have heard him calling to his heart's content. We're on his tracks. Unfortunately, just before I went to bed when I was listening, I do think he's probably passed through Juma on his patrol last night, but we do have tracks. I will estimate these tracks from when I last heard him calling to be about 11 p.m. last night. And he's walking straight down Zoe's Road. And then I'm going to see if I'm right from my ears. I think he then cut further to the north and went back towards the gate. But let's stick on the tracks for now. It is going to be an absolutely beautiful morning. Hopefully we can keep our cat run going. If not, I shall be showing you lots of flowers and butterflies. But it is wonderful to be out this time of the morning. And just a quick reminder, before I forget, more than anything else, is that our times are changing tomorrow, and tomorrow is the first, so we will be going out half an hour later, and that's to avoid this deep darkness we're sitting in at the moment. So it is a little bit difficult to see tracks, and it is a little bit difficult to show you things in the dark, so we will be going out half an hour later. So in 1 second. On Eastern Standard Time, we're going out at midnight until 3 a.m. And on Pacific Time, we'll be going out from 9 p.m. to midnight. And that's for the Sunrise Safari, which we're on at the moment. And for the Sunset Safari, we'll be going out from 9:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. If you're in the eastern part of the United States. And in the western part, we'll be going out from 6:30 a.m. till 9:30 a.m. So exciting times. And we definitely have sort of hit that summer-winter change. And we can feel the nip in the air in the mornings. And the clouds have dissipated. There's almost zero humidity. Fortunately, we still are enjoying the last few beastly hot days of summer. And I think today is going to be another one of them with not a cloud in the sky. But let's get going. Let's stop chatting. Let's get tracking. Sorry, I thought I heard something. Oh, Kevin. Kevin, I think Connor the Carnivore. Kevin has been listening to the dam cam, and he said the best way to describe the sounds of last night was a buffalo fighting with a goose. Now, that is something I would like to see, Kevin. But I think one sound we definitely heard last night on the dam cam would have been Tingana walking through, and he would have been rasping, so... But I think the sound you're describing, Kevin, is maybe impala rutting. So lots of snorting. I'm not even going to try attempt that. But probably impala rutting. And you know what, Kevin? There might have been a goose. It's very possible Egyptian goose would have sat there during the night and made some funny noises. Sorry, I'm just trying to see if those leopard tracks left the road, which I think they did. Sneaky Tingana. I'm going to keep checking in case they come back. I think he went into scent mark a bush before returning, and I'm pretty sure, here we go, he scent marked this termite mound. Now, I have seen him scent mark this very termite mound before, and a lot of leopards on their different routes have particular areas they're quite fond of urinating on. Now, it's been a few hours, so we're not getting that wonderful smell of buttered popcorn that we get when it's really fresh. So I think we're a few hours behind him. Hopefully we can catch up with him. I do have to go quite slowly to make sure I don't miss where the tracks leave the road, which I think I already have missed. No, he's still there. Dave, are you feeling lucky? Are we going to find this leopard? Ah, Dave thinks it's going to be a special morning. I agree with him. Snoop is just mentioning that the fact that Dave's thumb doesn't look that dangerous, but don't worry. The most dangerous thumb in the business will be returning from holiday today, and that is Brian Joubert. Dave's thumb will be going on holiday for the next 2 weeks, and I'm sure a lot of you will be very happy to know that Commander Bond, sometimes known as James or James Henry, will be back on drive this evening on the Sunset Safari. So you will be back to three of us, and where has this leopard gone? Sorry, I am so distracted while looking for tracks, but so James will be back on drive this evening, and so will Brian Joubert. Now, while we try to figure out exactly where this leopard's gone, I just want to show you that horizon quickly, and look at those colors. Isn't that magnificent? But while we continue to follow up on the tracks of Tingana, let's go say a good morning to Jamie.
And a very good morning to all of you across the world, and welcome to our sunrise safari. For those of you who are new to our safari, my name is Jamie, and I have Jean-Ray on camera with me this morning. And we are off while Brent goes searching for Tingana, the dominant male leopard in this area. And who knows, maybe even signs of the Nkuhumas coming back into this side of Juma. I'm busy looking to see if I can find Karula. I've actually avoided the place where she had her kill last night. She was munching on a baby in Yala when I left her. But because she was on the ground and because it was dark, I didn't want to spotlight her, add any kind of distraction. So I left her alone to munch away at her dinner. Now I'm just checking very carefully along the pathway that she walked. So yesterday, she hadn't returned to her kill. Yesterday morning, and then at the start of yesterday's sunset safari. And I went back to check where she'd crossed out to go and feed her cubs in the Bulgari, only to find tracks crossing right back in, straight over her previous set of cubs. So she walked a really direct set path towards her cubs and then back again. What I want to see now is if she's done the same thing during the night, if she's gone in that direction again, back towards where her cubs are. And it was phenomenal to watch her, because from where we had her at Treehouse Dam, and when I almost immediately lost her coming into this block, it was because she was moving so incredibly fast. She covered a kilometer in about 10 minutes, if not more. I mean, if not less. She just kept moving further and further ahead of us. I want to just see if that's what she's done. If I don't see any signs of her, then we will go back to where the kill was and just see if she's still around there. I don't think so, though. She only had half of the Inyala, or would it be a third of the Inyala left. And it was a small Inyala. It was a young baby. And when we left her, she was tucking into it voraciously last night. We could hear the crunching and the chewing, even if we couldn't see her through the long grass and in the dark. The other option, of course, is that she heard Tingana calling, and she might have decided to wander across in his direction. It's a little bit unlikely, but it's a possibility. welcome to Shell Bell, who was watching on YouTube and was watching the dam camera before our safari started. And Shell Bell, you're wondering where we are in Africa. And the answer is we're in our own little portion of Juma and called Juma and Arethusa Game Reserves, which falls into the Sabi Sands Reserve, which then in turn is open to the Greater Kruger National Park area in South Africa. Just up in the sort of almost in the northeastern corner of one of the most beautiful countries in the world. And the place that we're in is famous for, first of all, we're very close to where there is the highest lion density in Africa. That's just a little bit further to the east of us around Sitara in the Kruger National Park. And we're in a reserve that is famous for their amazing leopard sightings. So both Brent and myself this morning on a mission to see if we can't find you one of those beautiful cats. That being said, I know that there are some of you who will be pining for the hyena den. It's been a while since we've been there. So I will go and check that out at some point this morning as well, see if there's any sign of them being out and about. It just depends on how the morning goes. I'm yet to go out on a drive that has gone according to the plan that I had set in my mind as to what was going to happen. It is fairly impossible to plan out a drive and to have it go exactly the way you expected it to. For all we know, we could have a pack of wild dogs run across the road in front of us. Well, stump there. And find ourselves in a mad chase after them. Or Ava, you're saying, or a honey badger. And you wish we could see a honey badger. I also wish we could see a honey badger. It's been a little while since I've seen one of them. It's one of my favorite things about being out at this time in the morning in the bush is that you get to see all kinds of small and rare nocturnal animals like honey badgers, porcupines, civet, the genet that Brent spotted last night. All of those are distinct possibilities. I still haven't picked up on Karula's tracks around here. That doesn't mean she didn't walk this way, though. And just to go back to Brent's large spotted genet sighting. All right, let me just concentrate on looking and spotlighting and not driving Gendre and myself off the damn wall, which I'm sure Gendre would prefer not to do.
Yes.
TV Stain has just said that he watched the clip of the genet and had to Google what it was because they'd never heard of an animal like a genet before. It's a strange little creature. If I had to describe it in the simplest and probably evolutionarily wise inaccurate manner, I would describe it as a cross between a mongoose and a cat. That's sort of the impression that they give me. They are, of course, in their own separate family completely, known as the Viverrids, the Viverridae family, and their closest relative being the civet. The Viverrids, the mustelids, so the honey badgers, and the Herpestidae family, the mongoose family, all share some common link back to a common ancestor. They've got quite a few traits in common, even though they live completely different, have completely different social structures, come in totally different sizes. But they do have a link, and that link is made clear in the presence of an anal gland that works very similar to that of a skunk, not quite to the same degree, but when threatened, they are capable of producing a foul and noxious smelling odor. Just want to check, this is where she walked yesterday, and I see her tracks, but they're yesterday's tracks. It was so much fun yesterday afternoon. As we were driving down, I turned around and said to Dave, "Dave, these tracks are so fresh, I swear I can smell her." And I walked around, drove around one corner, and she was standing right in the middle of the road. It was terribly convenient. she may be, she didn't walk the same path that she did the night before last or yesterday afternoon. She's changed her route. Maybe she got distracted by water, maybe she got distracted by Tingana. Although leopards are solitary animals, they do occasionally encounter each other and connect for a little while before moving off. She wouldn't, of course, be mating with him at this stage, not with the cubs the age that they are. But she might have met up with him for a bit before moving off. Florida, Brent was busy describing the smell of leopard urine and how comparing it to the smell of freshly buttered popcorn. And you were wondering what it is in the leopard's urine that makes it smell like that, since you've heard me saying before that I'm the only person that doesn't smell it. And Mike, I honestly don't know what it is about my sense of smell that I don't associate the smell of leopard urine with buttered popcorn, because I'm the only person I know that doesn't interpret it that way. Maybe there's just a slightly skewed nerve somewhere in my olfactory center in my brain that doesn't quite associate leopard urine with buttered popcorn. I don't know what it is. I've tried and I've tried, and I really have. I mean, I've watched leopard scent mark and then, which is a bit weird, drive up next to the bush and have a good sniff around it, just to see if I can see what everybody's going on about when they talk about buttered popcorn. But I think I'm the one that's wrong, because it's not just Brent, it's everybody that I've spoken to smells it that way. So obviously I've just got a link in a nerve receptor cell somewhere that isn't functioning as it should in my interpretation or comparison. And I mean, it's not that I can't smell buttered popcorn. I know what buttered popcorn smells like. It's one of the best smells possible. I don't know what it is, but it's just one of those things that I've never put the two together and associated them. We've just driven past Treehouse Dam, and most of our regular viewers would have been shown the remainders of the treehouse on the marula tree that would have overlooked Treehouse Dam. And Lael was wondering, has a leopard ever taken a kill up towards the treehouse at Treehouse Dam? Probably. The tree is relatively suitably situated, and if you think about how long or how many opportunities there are every day, you'll probably find that yes, a leopard has definitely done that. Personally, I haven't seen it, but that doesn't mean that it hasn't happened. I'm sure, and I wonder if any of our regular viewers have ever seen a carcass hoisted in the treehouse tree. I'd love to hear if you have. I love those little bits of reserve history. Got her tracks coming out. Just want to check this junction very carefully for tracks going back in. It's right at that stage where the spotlight isn't doing too well. All right, I want to just hop out and double check, make sure I don't miss her tracks. While I do that, let's find out how Brent's going.
So we're still hot on the trail of Mr. Tingana. He left the road and he went off in a westerly direction. So we're just making sure he didn't double back. I'm quite confident he didn't. What I am hoping, fingers crossed, is that he has found something to stalk in that block, and that's why he left the road. I'm just double checking all the way through to the southern edge of our traverse, and then I'm gonna head up the border between Arethusa and Juma to see if he's crossed. And of course, if he's crossed into Arethusa, we will continue on the tracks. If not, fingers crossed, it means he's somewhere near the Balanites tree. There's a very big block. And when I refer to a block, it's just an area between the roads that doesn't have any main roads in it. But he does disappear into this block quite frequently, and there are a lot of animals in it, so there's a good chance maybe he was a bit more successful in his hunting last night. So we're just going to check a big loop around. If nothing, I'm going to go back to his last tracks and have a little stroll. Something has been sleeping in the road here, and it is not a big cat. It is a buffalo. That's a bit disappointing. A bit disappointing and very positive. So we are really hoping he's somewhere in this area behind us. And also in the area we're heading to at the moment, the Nkuhumas were found yesterday, about 4 kilometers to the west of our boundary with Sibambili. And fingers crossed, and I'm feeling a little bit of a twitch in my leg that they've come back. So we will be searching for those as well. But we're going to try and stick on Mr. Tingana for now. And we need to find a cat today. We have to find a cat today. We need to keep it going, keep our streak going. If we find a cat today, it'll be 8 days on the trot so far. 7 days on the trot with big cats on either both or one of the safaris. And we are going to attempt, I don't want to jinx it, but we are going to attempt to break my record from last year, which was 29 days on the trot with big cats. Very exciting. I had to go and leave. I nearly didn't want to go on leave, so I didn't want to end my streak. But unfortunately, it ended. So we're going to try to see if we can get close to that. But on my own little personal mission, and I know a lot of you guys have been involved in this, it's to see how many species of the order Carnivora we can possibly get on camera. And we added the large spotted genet last night. Wonderful view, a very quick view because we were following the leopard and we didn't want to keep the light on the genet, making him Tingana bait. But very, very exciting. So far on the live drives, there's about 23 different members of the order Carnivora that we can see here at Juma. Now that's just hyena, and that is one of the order Carnivora. So far, I think we're sitting just over 10 members of the order Carnivora that we have managed to put on camera. We have, of course, the big scaries and easies, the lion, the leopard, the wild dog, the cheetah, and the hyena. Spotted hyena, not brown. I think I might do jumps of joy and do a jig if we ever spot a brown hyena. So we got 5 there. We got white-tailed mongoose, which is 6. We have African civet, which is 7. We have slender mongoose, 8. And we have serval, 9. Dwarf mongoose, 10. The large spotted genet, which is 11. So we got to 11 so far. We've got a few more to find. And as I said, this is definitely not a short-term project to try and get as many members of the order Carnivora on camera as possible. So 11, I think I might be missing one. Kyle says that genet last night looks like a cross between a serval and a raccoon. To me, Kyle, it looked just like a genet. fortunately, a serval and raccoon, they don't crossbreed, so we don't have many hybrids of that ilk running around. But yes, quite often a genet is referred to as a genet cat, which is actually very incorrect. So a lot of people think it's part of the cat family. It's not, it's part of the Viviridae family. And now the Viviridae family holds quite a lot of different individuals, including civet and mongoose. So the best way to describe is it's sort of like a nocturnal mongoose, like a nocturnal slender mongoose, because it is generally a solitary beast. Now, I'm just going to have a quick chat with this vehicle who's coming past, and I'll tell you the strangest genet sighting I've ever had. Now, believe it or not, when I was growing up, we actually had a pet genet called Genevieve. She was a very sweet girl, quite fond of me, but I'll explain about that a little bit more in a second.
Ha Minja!
Ramdan!
Ah, Boogie!
Yeah!
How are you, Ransom?
Good.
Sup? Good thing, yeah. I thought you were going to do my work for me. You say, I was going to the Ingres and Gala.
Hello, Tempo.
Okay, thanks, Tempo.
Yeah.
Okay, were the Birmingham's your side last night?
Yeah, but they went to Malamala.
They went to Malamala. Okay. Tingana lost in Konzo's here, but I think he's heading towards other things. Yeah, I'm going to check Triple M now. Last track, so just in the block here.
Okay.
And Karula's got Nyama on the Juma. But she's from back forward for the month.
Where's my people?
Mivagari.
Oh, still there?
Yeah, the console's going backwards and forwards.
But that's not Adama Pimpan
for Shadow.
Ganyin.
Oh, okay. Okay. Nkomfo?
Nkomfo.
Have a good morning. Don't get into trouble, don't get lost.
Yeah.
Here we go. Just a little morning meeting with Ransom. And update on the Birminghams. They have headed into the south, so out of the northern part of the Sabi Sands. Oh, it's busy this morning. Maybe the next car has seen something for us to look at. Oh, nice new Land Cruiser. Ah, hey!
Hey, Madume!
Minjal!
Hey, Pukula Minjal!
Oh, got the tunes going, ne?
Yeah.
Any numbers at loot?
Ah, loot.
I'm going for.
Yeah.
Drive safe.
Ciao.
Bye bye.
Ciao.
Now, the wonderful thing about people in the bush is we're all happy as Larry at 4 a.m. in the morning or 5 a.m. So we all are morning people. If you are not a morning person, you are going to suffer in the line of work that we do. Most of us have the fortunate thing is basically when our feet touch the ground, we're awake. Cameramen, not so much. They take a little bit of poking in the morning. Especially Dangerous Dave, who's on camera with me today. But I even thought about purchasing a cattle prod to make them awake faster. A good morning to Teresa, who's a first-time viewer. Great to have you on the back of the vehicle today, Teresa. And as you know, we are in search of the elusive leopard. But Teresa... Karula has left the property. She's gone back to where she's keeping the cubs. I will explain that, or I'll let Jamie explain that a little bit more. Sorry, let me just turn this down. But Teresa's wondering, how long have we been doing these safaris and what training is required? Well, Teresa, I personally have been involved in the live safari since February last year, but they have been running on and off since I think 2008. I might be wrong, but I think it's around there. But the current sort of version or season or whatever you would like to call it has been running every day since I think February or January last year. I joined in February. And in terms of training, it's a very interesting one. So most of us have been safari guides for quite a long time in different places. I have pretty much been in the bush my whole life. And I've grown up in safari lodges and basically on the back of a game drive vehicle. So I got my training from starting at about 4. But normally, of course, a certain level of competency is required. What's very interesting is that most times on a safari, we have wonderful guests coming from all over the world, but they don't normally stay for longer than 4 days. The amazing thing about what we do is we have thousands of people that join us, not for 4 days, but for 4 weeks, 4 months, 4 years, they just keep coming back. It is great to have all of you guys on the back. I'm just checking for tracks while I'm talking to you here, Teresa, just making sure we don't miss out on this leopard. And
So there is definitely a certain level of training, and you'll find most of the live guides are pretty well qualified and well versed in the ways of the bush, and it is great to be able to do this and share our passion and our love and our knowledge of Africa with whoever's out there watching us. And for me, one of the most amazing things is that this is actually live. So I can have a conversation with you through this camera, Teresa, and you wherever you may be, will be sitting on the back of my game drive vehicle. So it is amazing that we're able to reach such a wide audience and spread the conservation word, so to speak, and at the same time, show you some animals and have some fun. So while we keep checking for the tracks of this male leopard, let's go see what a Jamie's got.
We've just stumbled across a bachelor herd of mature impala rams. I was hoping one of them sort of gave a really half-hearted chase of the other, and I was hoping maybe they'd show you some of their playful sparring behavior that they've been demonstrating over the last few days. Unfortunately, it seems as though breakfast is a little bit more entertaining than chasing each other around at this time of the morning. We're coming up to the impala rutting season, so the impala breeding season, and as a result, the males have started to split more and more into these bachelor groups, with the breeding herds largely grouped together, groups of females and youngsters with one or two big rams in attendance. I'm just going to go back slightly just in case they do decide to chase each other around. We've got a better view. Or is breakfast just more interesting? But yes, they're splitting into these bachelor herds, and they're spending a lot of their time prepping for the rut so that their hormone levels have increased, making them slightly more aggressive, definitely making them noisier, as was heard on the Juma Dam camera last night, and we're going to be hearing that more and more. But what that does is that the rise in hormones before the actual mating season, oh, I thought he was going to go for it there, will give them time to practice sparring with each other before they actually need to use those skills. So it builds up their form. And allows them to practice their techniques. This guy does have a floppy left ear. That's interesting. I thought I was imagining it because, of course, all... Oh, no, it still kind of works. No. Oh. There is something slightly wrong with it. It's a bit floppy, but he's still got quite a large degree of muscular control over it. Of course, antelope can redirect their ears in any which direction they want to, and completely independently of each other. So they can hear behind them and in front of them at the same time, and still determine exactly how far away the sound is, which direction it's coming from. So whilst he's still got a little bit of control over it, he can twitch it. Seems as though the muscle that runs along the top that holds it more upright is not as well developed or has been damaged in some way. Could even be from sparring. Off he goes. Are they going to... No, he's just going for a little bit of a morning jog back to the rest of them. Now, I know that Brent gave you that update about Karula crossing back south. She didn't walk the exact same path that she did yesterday, but almost very close to walking that same path. She's gone back towards where her cubs are hidden on Little Gowrie. And so I think we will meander up towards the hyena den, find out if any of them are up and about just yet. Let's leave these impala to their breakfast, since they're not showing any sign of sparring, and see what other things we can find. Django, are my headlights still on?
Yeah.
Cool, no problem. Just checking. Thought I was going crazy. My switch for my headlights has stopped working, which means that I have to ask the cameraman every now and again to either turn them on or turn them off. So, a great deal of fly activity at the moment. I think they're already out this early in the morning. Thank you very much to Aaron. Aaron says that he is a long-term viewer. To go back to the conversation we had around Treehouse Dam and the question about whether or not we had ever seen a carcass in the tree where the treehouse used to be, Aaron tells me that he's a long-term viewer and that he does remember seeing a carcass in that tree at some point, which doesn't surprise me at all. Generally, leopards, when they hoist a kill, there's a couple of factors that they consider, so this is a general rule rather than an absolute, but they do tend to favor marula trees and jackalberries, and occasionally torchwoods or balanites trees. And the reason behind that, first of all, there's no thorns, so you know that makes total rational sense. You don't really want to be trying to drag your food up and then feed on it whilst playing dodge the thorn. Then at the same time, the marula trees and the jackalberries tend to, especially in summer, have a nice thick crown of dark leaves that will act as a way to hide the carcass from any prying eyes of vultures. Vultures or any other birds of prey that might want to come and scavenge from it. So that marula tree that the treehouse is built on would probably have been a perfect spot for a leopard to hoist its kill. That being said, those are the general rules. If a leopard finds a convenient bush willow tree, for example, close to where their kill is, if the kill is particularly large and they don't feel like dragging it to a nearby appropriate tree, then they will hoist it in whatever they can. But I would say marulas would be the highest on the list, and then jackalberries. I think for yesterday, Karula hoisted her kill up into a tambwati tree, which was just happened to be the nearest, most convenient big tree. It was a jackalberry a bit further down the drainage line, but it didn't seem to be worth her while going all the way in that direction. And it served its purpose. It kept her kill safe for the 24 hours that she left it and went to go and feed her cubs, safe from birds of prey, safe from hyena. So she picked a very good spot to pop that kill. Tracks from yesterday. It's amazing how attuned you get to tracks, even where you know. I drove this road yesterday afternoon. I know her tracks are going up this way because I saw her walking up this road. And yet as soon as my brain sees a track, as soon as my eyes see a track, I immediately have to stop and investigate it, which I suppose is a good thing because you don't want to make the assumption that just because you know there are leopard tracks on this road doesn't necessarily mean that it was the only leopard that walked down the road. Just listening to the game drive comms. See what everybody's plan is and whether there's any updates from yesterday. Listen to Brent's updates about Tingana's tracks and whether or not they have crossed towards Arapuza. I think that might also be on the cards today. We appear to be having some sound issues. And it seems just to investigate what's happening. While I try and fix this, let's go back over to Brent.
So we have been in the search of this male leopard, and we've done this big loop. And as I was heading back to where I last saw tracks, you've got to love it when a good plan comes together. And you can see he's walked straight down the road here. A little bit to the left there. There we go. There is tracks. So pretty convinced this is Tingana. Now let's see where he went from here. Just a quick update on other leopards out and about. Shadow and her cubs have been found this morning, and they are right on the edge of Arethusa. Now, I'm sure a lot of you are wondering why we haven't been there, and it's just that the fact that those cubs are still very young. And copy orbs, yeah. I've just got Nkonza now coming on Balanati's onto Impala Plains and heading northwest.
Okay,
go ahead. And we will definitely go have a look at Shadow's cubs as soon as possible when they are able to climb trees. Hey, firm, Chris. So what happens with sightings like that is that if you happen to bump into them, then you do view them for a little bit. But to actively go, look at that, Dad. And I know it's a very common bird, but it's just very pretty with that sky behind. And a little bit, there we go. No, up a bit, there we go, the one sitting on top. Those little Cape turtle doves, all fluffy in the cool morning. Isn't that sweet? Doing a bit of cleaning and prepping. Now, it's always good to sit and turn off the car every now and then. You never know what you might hear. I'll leave those turtle doves to get ready for their busy day of feeding on grass seeds. Quite interesting. Now the ground's got quite hard here, so I haven't seen where the tracks go. Let me just finish quickly on Shadow. So we will definitely go there as soon as the cubs are old enough to climb trees, and we don't feel like we're putting too much pressure on it. So as I said, if we bump into those type of sightings, so we will view it, but then quite soon afterwards we will leave them and zone it. And it is absolutely excellent. We've got so many cubs about at the moment. And I cannot wait to spend some time with those little bundles of joy. So we're just checking very carefully here, see if, because he left the road up there, but I'm almost certain he's gonna come back onto this road. So far, not yet, but the only tracks over there now are wildebeest. Who knows, maybe he saw something to stalk. Dave, I hope you're checking for tree climbing impalas. Good man. What is that? Just checking that big tree there. That one there, just there's a funny silhouette. What is that? Is that just a funny looking branch? It is too. I got quite excited for a second, but it is just a funny looking branch. And Carl has picked up. Well done, Carl. And I forgot. Now I have to start my list again on carnivores. So the which ones? I think we've got to 11. What was it? 11 or 12? I think it was 11. Let's just do it quickly. Oh, we did get to 11. So we actually are on 13. So we have seen both blackback and side-striped jackal on the live safaris. So of course I have seen quite a few of them outside of safari time. That doesn't count. I'm only counting the ones I get to share with you. I'm just going to check a little bit down this road. If we don't have anything, I'm going to go back to where I saw the last of Tingana's tracks and just have a quick look so we can see which way he went. Fortunately, lions and leopards often walk down the road, and the road networks are designed, they are on big old animal paths, and the nicest thing about the big cats is they're often quite obliging. They don't really like dew, so they tend to walk down the road so they don't get wet paws and wet faces. So we've got 13 members of the order Carnivora, and it's going to be difficult to get the rest. And the ones we are missing so far, and I think some of them are going to be incredibly difficult to find. I mean, if we talk about Aardwolf, the last Aardwolf seen in the Sabi Sands was in the 1970s. But who knows, I feel I'm lucky enough that maybe we might be able to rectify that injustice. And so we are missing banded mongoose, which I have seen quite a few times off air. Go ahead, Orbs. 1 second, guys.
Go around and check junction of Bridge Road.
Copy, thanks, Orbs. Can't see which way that Nkonzo went off from Balanites on Impala Plains. I'm just checking towards the power lines in Impala, on Impala Road. If no Nkonzo, I'll go back to last tracks.
Hi, what must be the same Nkonzo? Because it was the power line to the north. So I'm going to check the gentleman exit junction of Bristol.
Copy, thanks very much, Orbs. So Aubrey has helping me in following up with these leopard tracks, and it seems like he's cut straight north across here.
Yeah, this is Valen Ponzo from Valen Cutline.
Lions down in the south. East.
North wind. And then he's pulling here.
Quite a long way away from our eastern boundary. So yeah, I was just saying, so the members of the order Carnivora that we still need to get, this banded mongoose, which I actually have seen a couple of times. Not that common here without any major rivers or river systems. Can you think of any others, Dave? Let's test Dave now. So we've got 23 possible species, and we're sitting on 13. So
give it a think.
Banded mongoose is one. Another one that I would love to be the first person to catch on camera is the caracal, of course, which is a medium cat. It's sort of between a leopard and a serval. Very stocky, beautiful cat called the caracal. And African wild cat is another one. So that's 16. And oh, we've mentioned Aardwolf, that's 17. Where is that sitting in the tree? You see that sitting in the light there? Where are my binoculars? There they are. Down to the left. Oh, it flew. You're forgiven, but there was a pin-tailed wider. Oh, some magpie shrikes as well. That's what Dave found in the top of that tree. We'll just have a quick look while he's there. But there was also a pin-tailed wider. And there we go, there's a magpie shrike. Now, this is a very aggressive little bird of prey. But let's go to Jamie, who's got a bigger one.
Oh, we just arrived on quarantine, and as we did, an African harrier hawk came flying past us, closely accompanied by a lilac-breasted roller that was intently dive-bombing it. And it settled, trying to hide in this marula tree, and I'm hoping it might stay there. Let's get you a view first, so that you can see the bird I'm looking at. This is one of my favorite birds, personally. I find them incredibly interesting looking. The proportion of their heads to their bodies and that really beautiful stony gray color. I think one of the things I enjoy the most is how difficult they are to actually get on camera. For some reason, this particular individual that hangs around here is so shy. Probably because every single little bird that sees it attempts to dive bomb it in some way. There are known nest raiders with double jointed legs that can twist backwards completely. It doesn't make them terribly popular in the bird world. I'm gonna try now. Just trying to think where would be the best point of view. I'm gonna try a shuffle a little bit to the side. Let's see if we can't get a clearer shot of him. At the moment, he's managing to stay hidden. Avoid the attentions of the other little bird species. It's particularly drongos that go after harrier hawks. Drongos and lilac-breasted rollers. No, this isn't really going to work. See him there? Now, the previous view that we had, you could see the yellow face of the African harrier hawk, or the gymnogene. Now, when they're particularly stressed, or when there's been some kind of competition with other individuals of the same species, that face flushes a bright red color. It is interesting to see, there's not that many birds that do that out here and have such a clearly expressive response to stress. Okay, I think unfortunately that's going to be the extent of our view. I was hoping he might show you some of their acrobatics moving underneath and around tree branches, looking for various nests to raid. But to be honest, I think he or she is just enjoying the peace and tranquility that comes from having not been spotted by rollers and fork-tailed drongos and other birds that would be quite keen to chase him. I always think it's incredible how tiny little birds, like a fork-tailed drongo. Oh, there he goes. Immediately the squirrel going. Oh, and he's landed perfectly in a trunk there. I think I see. Oh, yep, he's being mobbed again. Quick, let's see if we can get a view this side. Oh, he's flying again. Fork-tailed drongos have spotted him. And I've lost track. Can't see where he's gone. But it is amazing how the little bird species really enjoy, or really, oh, there he is. Perfect, that's what I wanted to see. The way that he's clinging onto the side of the tree. And gone again. I've just seen fork-tailed drongos swooping in, and a starling as well joining in. You might even see that bright face flush. Not yet. This is a very cool sighting. See how the crest is up? So even though the face isn't flushed yet, this bird is a little bit upset with the attentions of the smaller birds. Oh, there we go. Awesome, Gendre. Drongo is swooping in. Awesome. Look at the starling making sure that it's moved away from any nest sites. Cool, man. Well done, Gendre. Our brilliant cameraman at work. I'm going to look for one more view of this bird, depending, just because it's so fascinating to witness its behavior. And I can see it sitting in the apple leaf. but it's drawn the attention of all kinds of little birds in the air. Oh, there he goes again. Chandra, clear view. He's now accompanied by starlings, fork-tailed drongos. Doves have even joined in. He must be terribly unimpressed with life. Trying to find a nice, suitable roosting spot. There he goes, all the way back there. Well done, Jandre. The starlings are in hot pursuit. And off we go. And as we watched him flying off, we had a question about the wingspan of this particular bird. So it's one of the smaller raptor species. If I had to guess, and it would be a guess, probably about 3 foot, maybe a bit longer. Gary, you were wondering, I would guess close to maybe just over a meter. I'll double check for you in a moment as soon as I've got another view. It's not a large bird of prey, but it is a particularly attractive one. Oh, we're playing tree to tree, accompanied by a starling, making escorted away from the area by a starling. There he goes. Well done, Jandre. Right. This is one of the last Maroola trees on quarantine clearing, so if he disappears from us now, then this will be our last view of him. This really hasn't been his morning, though, or her morning. Impossible to tell. I would love to know if this is the same harrier hawk that has a nest on Vulture's Nest Road in the middle of the reserve. Isn't it beautiful? And it will continue throughout the day to move from tree to tree. Now, just because they are specialized nest raiders, that doesn't mean that that is the only thing that they can hunt. Although he will go, he will move from nest to nest and tree to tree, he could well also go after anything from rodents to snakes as well. I'm just trying to check for Gary exactly what the wingspan is. But for some reason, I've forgotten how to use an index or how the alphabet works. Sorry, Gary. Bear with me 1 second. At least we've got a nice view of him to keep us occupied. Oh, for goodness sake. Why am I being so silly? Oh, there we go. I'm being very silly. So, Gary, you've only given me the height of the bird rather than the wingspan in this particular textbook or reference book. So it's about 2 feet in height, under a meter, 60-odd centimeters in height, 60 to 70. But my guess is that its wingspan is close to a meter, if not larger. You can hear the starling, how upset it is. Oh, even longer. Apparently its wingspan is actually over that. It is a meter and a half. So what is that? That's 4 feet, 4.5 feet in wingspan. It's actually bigger than I realized. So 1.5 meters wingspan, 5.2 feet. That's how large our bird is. And a gray hornbill, I was about to say, is going to join in the party of attempting to scare away this poor bird. I say poor bird, it is possibly a threat to every bird's offspring here in this area, which is why they all band together to chase it away. And I've noticed that specifically with harrier hawks, usually the birds will, drongos will dive bomb something like a snake eagle for a while and then get bored and fly off and leave it alone. With harrier hawks, the birds persist and persist and persist. Once it is spotted, and he's had it, he's off. Oh, Brent has found the leopard. Let's go to him.
So, tracking has been successful. And we've managed to find Mr. Tingane. It looks like he has made a kill during the night, but you can see that dirt on his face, but I think he's probably lost the hyenas looking at his but slightly nervous demeanor. So a wonderful track so far this morning. I do love finding my own animals. It's so much more rewarding than going to animals found by someone else. But there we go. Mr. Tingane, oh, has he spotted something? He spotted something. Ooh. As I said, it definitely looks like he made a kill. But it's very, very, very close. But quickly off to Jamie, who's also got something fascinating.
This is, sorry to take you away from the leopard. We won't be gone long. This is just the most incredible sighting of a harrier hawk. It's found a nest that it's trying to get into, and the birds are desperately trying to defend it. Look how its crest is up. It keeps snapping its bill at every bird that comes past it. And there's clearly something in there that it wants. This is the first time I've ever managed to get this. Look, look, it's going right in. The hornbill's desperately dive-bombing it. Could well be a grey hornbill nest. Trying to reach far enough inside. Look at how it's clinging upside down to that tree. Hear the frantic whistles of the grey hornbills. I think it might be their nest. That was a roller that just dive-bombed it. I just had to show you that. He hasn't been successful. Let's go back to the leopard.
Guys, he's busy stalking impala. Some impala just crossed the road. This is incredibly exciting. He's not very far from them. I'm just going to try to get us in a position where we can be in between him and the impala. Oh, he got spotted, silly Tingane. He definitely rushed that stalk. You got him? Listen to those impala. He rushed that. He was a little bit over-eager. He ran down the road in the open and he got spotted. He's just looking a bit frustrated. I think he definitely lost a kill to hyenas last night. See, now look at this, tail up. The impala running right in front of him. There we go. So once he's been spotted, the game is sort of up. So when the leopard raises its tail like that, he's sort of admitting defeat. So I'm just gonna let pull off the road here so Aubrey can have a good look as well. He has been helping me track him. Listen to those impala. That one impala's got a very strange snort. So he's got impala on either side of him, and since he's been spotted, and he puts his tail up, sort of admits defeat. So I'm just gonna let Aubrey jump ahead of me, so we're gonna leapfrog him for now, taking turns in the front. Morning, morning. So he is heading there towards our sort of northwestern corner. I am hoping that he doesn't disappear, but I think he actually is going to probably cross into Sibambili. This is his normal sort of route. And the streak continues, guys. So day 8 with big cats. Oh, those impala are mightily upset. There's funny, you could definitely hear the one male had a very strange snort. It was a rather than a pfft. And he is going into quite a difficult block at the moment. I'm just gonna try leap ahead of him for a bit and use one of my sneaky secret spots. So one of the best things about walking a lot, and I do love my tracking and walking, is that you learn there's little different gaps where you can access blocks with, which are sometimes a little bit more trying. And there we go. And this block is particularly difficult because of the elephants pushing down a lot of trees here. So you have to do quite a lot of zigging and zagging. And there's a beautiful little pan in here that I've actually found Mr. Tingana at on foot before. And I think he might stop for a drink, so we're just trying to get into position. And he is doing exactly that. He's drinking. So let's just sneak in here. He's having a drink. Oh, isn't this absolutely gorgeous? Here we go. How's that for you, Dave? Magic. Exactly. I agree. I'm just going to move a little bit further forward so Aubrey can also come in here. And let's get right opposite him while he's drinking. There we go. So we've got some... Oh, look at that. I hope you guys are getting some magnificent screenshots. I'm going to take a few pictures. So we can actually see that sort of dirt. It's not dirt around his face, I actually think it's stomach content. And I definitely think he's made a kill, but he was very close to the hyena den. And I think any noise, even those impala alarming that we just heard, might attract a hyena or three to come investigate. You guys might hear there's some aeroplanes out and about. Oh, isn't this absolutely beautiful? And we've been so lucky with the amount of time we've spent with this particular male in the last couple of days. He is absolutely gorgeous. Isn't this amazing? Oh, look at his little tail, how it curls. A leopard's tail has almost got a life of its own. It is one of the most fascinating things to watch. So you can hear him lapping. I do apologize about the aeroplanes, but they are a necessary evil. They are flying low and checking our boundaries for poachers and whatnot. So a huge welcome to O-Dot, who's a new viewer and is joining the Safari Live family. And O-Dot's asking, how can animals drink this water? It's completely filthy and dirty. Well, it's actually not that dirty, and it's just a little bit muddy, and probably got about 20% elephant urine. But other than that, it's completely fine. I'm probably sure I could drink this water and be 100%. It just probably wouldn't taste too nice. Now, you must understand that we're the only animals that really drink crystal clean water or have fascination with it. And they will have a lot of immunities to all sorts of things like Giardia and the stuff that affect us quite badly. And you would have found in the past, we would have had good immunity to a lot of these diseases when we were also forced to drink out of pans like this. But the longer we stay in cities and purify everything, the less tough we get. Oh dear, he is going to go into a very difficult area for us to follow. We will try. I'm now just trying to think of a way to get around. Oh, he's a beautiful leopard. So Susan and Russell say he looks like he's walking a bit stiffly in his back end. Is he arthritic or does he have a bit of an injury? I noticed that yesterday on the Sunset Safari. I think he might be carrying a little bit of a bruise, and it's more than likely from hunting. He's probably got a kick from an impala that he grabbed. We are going to try to stay with him, but as you can see, this is a very challenging area to off-road in. But we will definitely attempt. Have a quick chat with Orbs. Boy, you're going to try to go around. Okay, I'll try to stay with him. Let's think, how are we going to negotiate this very difficult area? Now, I'm not so worried about getting through it. I'm more worried about losing the cameraman. Occasionally, we have cameramen sort of hanging like marionettes on thorn trees, but it's okay.
I'll be all right.
Yes, there we go. Dave says he'll be all right. He thinks it's worth the risk to stay with the leopard. While we try to keep up with him, I'm definitely not going through there. I'll get stuck. While we try to keep up with him and find a route through here, let's go back to Jamie, who's with the hunting harrier hawk.
This has been one of the most incredible harrier hawk sightings I think I've ever had. Oh, I know where he's gone. He's gone to the marula tree. We can get there. I've been watching him ever since you left us to go across to Tingana. It's just gathered more and more birds. Rollers, starlings, hornbills, doves are all having a go at this harrier hawk, and it's just determinedly moving from tree to tree to tree. It really, truly is the most incredible harrier hawk sighting I think I've ever had. And this is so rare to see this in action, especially in this morning light where you can see all of the details perfectly. Oh, I hope we can catch up with him. I've learned so much from this sighting. There he is, I can see him. Just in terms of the way that harrier hawks go about their day-to-day business of nest raiding and checking each individual hole. Please don't fly back the other way. Please don't fly back the... Oh. Here he goes. And every now and again, the birds dive from him and he spreads that crest around his head and snaps his beak, or her beak. Oh, gone again. A game of catch up with a harrier hawk is definitely not how I imagined I'd be spending my morning. And it's just a, oh, there he goes again. And what's so incredible about the sighting is to see the behavior of the other birds. Oh, no. On to the next. The rollers, here they come. What's incredible to witness is the behavior of the other birds, the way that they dive bomb it. And it's an all for one, one for all kind of attitude, because if he doesn't find anything at your neighbor's nest, he will move on to yours. So all of the birds in the neighborhood coming out to see off the gangster. Go shuffle forward a bit. This truly is an extraordinary sighting. trying to keep eyes in the back of my head here. Where is he? He's somewhere in this tree, or has he flown off? I think he's still in here. I can hear the rollers still fussing, so he must be somewhere here. Margaret, you were wondering, or you were saying, isn't this the bird that flushes its face from yellow to pinkish in color? Yes, it is that bird. But I'm confused. I think it must have escaped us, because all of the birds in the area are taking off that way, rather than at the harrier hawk, or where I thought the harrier hawk was. I think we've lost him. How did he do that? Oh well, much longer sighting than I've ever managed to have before. You hear the parrot screeching now. All of the birds are flying off to the north of where I am now. I can't see anything in the tree where I last had visual. Okay. Well, fair enough. It was an exceptionally extended period of time. Let's just go check Zoe's, just because I don't really want this sighting to be over. I have enjoyed it tremendously. Just judging by where all of the birds flew off to. Oh, there's even brown-headed parrots. They're almost impossible to you. Well done, Gendre. That was a brown-headed parrot that was fluttering about, so even they are upset by the presence of the harrier hawk. I'm just checking carefully as I drive away that I haven't missed him somewhere, but I don't think so. There he goes. I got him. Still accompanied by his entourage of disgruntled birds. Stopping here, he's onto the next tree. Okay, he's not gone too far away. These birds getting closer and closer to actually pecking him. But not deterred, our harrier hawk still intently raiding nests. It's the only bird of prey that you will really see cling onto the sides of the branches like this and hang upside down. Look at that predatory walk, stalking along the branches. Look, it's pink, it's flushed pink. With all of the harassment from the other birds, it has flushed pink. The yellow face is taking on a different hue. On one hand, I want to get closer. On the other, I want to just wait and see if he's going to fly again. Okay. Let's chance it. Let's go. He's found something. Isn't this incredible? Don't fly, don't fly, don't fly, don't fly. Look at how he's hanging. This is incredible. Oh, he's got it, he got it. He got a baby. We got something out of there. He definitely came out of that crack with something in its claw. Where's he gone? Gone into this moon tree. There he is. He's still clinging onto it. I think it's a baby bird. So hard to tell. And now he's going to try and find somewhere to feed on that in peace. Wow. Apparently the ladies in final control have been watching that on slow motion, and it looks as though it is a squirrel that he's managed to catch, a baby squirrel. Any closer and I think he's gonna fly. He's still being dive bombed by the starlings. Just at a slightly wrong angle. I can see it dangling just at the bottom, and I think they're right. I think it is a squirrel. He's gone off in search of a better place to feed. This has been an incredible sighting. I've never seen a harrier hawk pull a baby squirrel out of a hole before. That's a first for me. I'm relatively certain it's going to be a first for most of you. I want to try and see. I think that this harrier hawk's... No, oh, there it goes. My mistake, it was still close. All right, it's gone into some very, very thick bush, and I don't think we're going to be able to keep up with it. I'll just have a look and see if there's another view. While I do that, and while I try to relocate it, the ladies in final control have actually prepared that slow-mo clip for you. So just have a look at how extraordinary this sighting really was. So definitely a squirrel, and it definitely made it worthwhile staying with that harrier hawk and watching that whole process unfolding. And we spoke about how the birds have been guarding so carefully their nests, and of course the poor squirrel was the one that got caught. Do you know, my initial thought, to be completely honest, when I saw that was bush baby, but it seems as though it was a squirrel. Distraction again from that extraordinary sighting, and I wonder if I can find a position where I can show you these tracks. I have a track quiz for you. Can you see those little tiny paw prints there, Jean-André? All right. This track, I'm going to jump out quickly for you. I'm going to jump out. I'm almost falling out the angle that I'm at. So these tiny little tracks, and I wanted to get out to double check that I'm right, but I am. Perfect, perfect little paw prints without any claws showing. Perfect round paw prints and barely larger than the tip of my thumb. Now what on earth could that be? This is one I have never asked you before. Let's see if you can figure out which tiny little animal with perfectly round paw prints has walked along this road. And quite, look, just look at the stride. That's the back left, that's the left side of the body. That's the right side of the body. And the left side of the body. Can you see that there, Jean-André? Perfect, thank you. And that's all the hint I'm going to give you. Let's see if anybody can get which particular creature left those tiny, tiny paw prints in the sand. Sure, what an exciting way to do a morning. And then for those of you who, we're going to do one last view of those tracks. For those of you who were talking about it was Janine, who mentioned yesterday that she wanted to build up a collection of tracking tips, basically like a bird list, but with screenshots of the different tracks. This is a good example, and it's a track that we don't often see. So definitely worth getting a screenshot of that. Okay, well, I've got other things to find you. In the meantime, let's find out how Brent is getting on with his search for Tingana.
So, Tingana managed to give us a slip in that very thick area. Just give me one second, sorry.
Aubrey.
Is Mala alarming close to the Buffleshook boundary?
And I've got Nkonzo going back north across the road.
Okay.
Just heard him calling. I would say almost near where that dead tree is. Mm. I mean, yeah, the squirrel's alarming, we just heard Impala alarming, and then once he got spotted and Impala started, he just decided, well, I've been spotted, I might as well make my presence well known with a little bit of a rasp. Okay, so Dave, eyes open. I guess he's in front of us here somewhere. Yes, around that dead tree is where we heard him calling from. But he's probably still on the move. Very upset squirrel, you can see him, but I must remember they're sitting high, so they can look quite far occasionally. Okay. Where are you, Mr. T? So the Impala alarming there, the squirrel alarming there, so I think he's in between us and them. Where are you hiding? Still going at it. He has chosen one of the worst areas to try follow him in. There you go, the Impala still going over there. Listen. There we go. Let's just try to find a route. Fortunately, there's a convenient elephant path here. Maybe not so convenient an elephant path. Lots of fallen down trees in the way. It sounds like he's on Sandy Patch from the Mala alarms, and he just vocalized. Oh, yeah. Getting through here is, of course, another story. This is definitely one of the more challenging blocks. So, Jamie's gonna make her way up into this area. To have three vehicles here would be more beneficial, just because while we try needle our way through the middle of this block, to have another vehicle standing by. Watch out, Dave. Don't worry, no thorns on that one. I hope you guys all ducked. Okay, I think we might get through from here. Ah, there we go. That's an Impala.
No.
Oh, you saw a leopard? Okay. Dave has seen a leopard. I only saw an Impala. But I'm gonna take Dave's word for him. So where are we looking at?
He ran on
He ran. Let's have a look. Maybe he was chasing an impala. Now, hear the impala that are snorting at him. So you saw him. Are you sure it wasn't an impala, Dave?
No.
Because I did see an impala running. Yes, this is a bit of deja vu of the impala lion Dave found once upon a time. And I think he is down towards that drainage system. So I'm just going to shoot at the head. Now, we could get a view of him from a distance here. There's no tracks coming across here. Monkeys alarming ahead, and that is definitely a first for me in the Sabi Sands, flying up there. It looks like a motorized paraglider, and maybe this is a new invention in anti-poaching. It's making a hell of a racket and stuff. Lots of things running and staring back towards us, but there's the impala alarming and the water buck jogging off. I think he's here somewhere in this little area.
It seems as though Brent has lost signal. I just had to rush back to camp. I now have Liam on camera with me this morning due to the fact that Jandre has to leave a little bit earlier to head off for a couple of days on leave. I'm just going to contact Brent on the Game Drive channel, try and get hold of him, see where he wants me to check. I assume he's going to say Aubrey's Road. Brent for Jamie. Brent. I'm just coming up, where's Access Road? Where would you like me to check? Okay, copy. I'll come along Aubrey's just to check along there, just in case. Brent's just telling me that the monkeys and the impala are alarm calling on Biffle's Hook. So there's a possibility, quite a strong possibility, that Tingana's already managed to cross Biffle's Hook cut line, the boundary to our north, and gone into an area where we cannot follow him. But at least we managed to get to see him. I've just been, while I was down at the camp, I was just thinking about this harrier hawk sighting and how incredible it is that all of the birds in the area defend and attack this, or try to chase this bird away, despite the fact that it might not be their nest at risk, even to the point that they tried to save that baby squirrel. And it makes complete sense in the sense that you've got to, you never know whose nest it might be. So that altruism in nature, that is a really, really clear example of it. Just turning my game drive channel down. What an incredible morning. See, nothing ever goes according to plan, and you never quite see exactly what you expect to. And I wonder whether any of you have figured out my track quiz yet. It's a tricky one, and it's one I haven't asked before. And in fact, that's the first time I've ever seen such a clear example of it. Safari Dean has guessed Serval, and Russell and Evie guessed Civet. All three of you have got the right sort of shape, but the size is completely different. So that track was about the size of the top half of my thumb, and I don't have particularly large hands. A civet track, on the other hand, would be about the size of a ping pong ball. If you stuck a ping pong ball in the sand, that would be the impression that it would leave, or that would be the size of a civet's track. A serval's track is also slightly bigger, similar shape, perfect little paw print, but you do get to see the three lobes at the back if you look very carefully. It's not... Now, Chelsea, you've guessed... Well, I've just found where the guys obviously found Tingana. I just saw his tracks coming up this road. Going straight up here. And Chelsea is in... one of our newer viewers has guessed some kind of fox. Now, that would, in our particular area, be limited to a jackal. And... the chances of us seeing a jackal in this area is relatively slim. We do see them occasionally, so that is a good guess. A jackal's paw print is slightly bigger. That's basically our equivalent of a fox. A jackal's paw print is a bit bigger, and it's got... Oh, I've forgotten my tracking book again. The claws are clearly visible in the track. And in terms of... there's quite a big distance between the back part of a jackal's pad, or the back part of a jackal's foot, and the space between the toes. And it's so, there's so much what we call in tracking terms negative space. So the part of the foot within the track that hasn't touched the ground, that in a jackal you can draw a perfect cross in between the toes and the back pad. A diagonal cross, like a multiplication sign, in the negative space within the track. And I'd have to show you specifically. Gail and Dory have guessed African wildcat. That's the closest that you've come. And I'll tell you why it's not an African wildcat. Is the length of the stride for an African wildcat would be further apart. Their legs are slightly longer, so they cover a little bit of a bigger distance. And unless it was an African wildcat kitten, which would have even smaller feet, it would not have that sort of length of stride. So the animal that we're thinking of has a long body. Okay, now I'm giving it away, because I think I might have caught you out here. a longish body and relatively to its body size, short legs. The African wildcat was the closest guess, though, in terms of size. An African wild tracks, African wildcat's track is a very similar size to the track that we looked at, slightly bigger, but the strides would be longer. Very well done to Raisa, Marianne, Shannon, and Aaron, all getting the guess right. It was a genet track. So the spotted, the large spotted or a small spotted genet, it's pretty much impossible to tell from their footprints. That is the animal that Brent had a lovely sighting of last night, and I'll show you a picture of the creature so that I can explain it for those of you who haven't seen that particular animal. But very well done to those of you who are newer viewers that guessed some really, really good guesses, considering there's a chance you haven't even seen it. I'm just going to listen to... Brent's just trying to chat to me. I'm going to show you a picture of a genet while I chat to him. That is a genet. Brent? Copy that, thank you. Very cute, very tiny, tiny little cat-like track. But it's not a cat. It is something that is completely separate from the cat family. It could also be the large spotted genet. A similar, very, very similar creature, but with a black tip to the end of its tail as opposed to the white tip. Awesome. Very well done for those of you who got it right. I know I've never asked that before. I'm not sure if you've ever been quizzed on that before. But a nice little one for our various tracking tips that we've been collecting over the last few weeks. Since I'm here on Aubrey's Road, I just thought I'd update you. I've been looking at the leopard tracks wandering up this road. Tingana has crossed our northern boundary into a property known as Buffle's Hook. Interesting behavior that we're seeing from him, that constant rasping call, I think responding to, oh, there's an elephant. Cool. There's lots of elephants. Hello, guys. Let's just stop here for one moment. Let them come. There's a little baby that got a little bit of a fright as we drove up. These two little babies. Oh, they're playing with each other. They're not stressed at all. Wonderful. I wonder which herd this is. Starting to get to know the individual herds quite well. There's a very large female off to the left there. Tusks, they are very much mobile, or fairly mobile for an elephant herd. And I think let's just wait here for the moment. Look at all the scratches on her ears and on her side there from walking through thick vegetation. Hello, Ellie's. Oh, look at your mouth full of grass that you've got there. Oh, it's gone already. That was obviously clearly enjoyable. It's a tuskless elephant. How very interesting. Right, this elephant is large enough to have grown its tusks by now, but it doesn't have any. And that is a naturally occurring trait in certain elephants. They lack tusks. It's in a natural situation, about 4% of elephants are born without tusks. Hello. I'm talking about your lack of tusks, but I promise you I'm not judging you for it. Hello. It's all right. How's it, big girl? Hello, big girl. You can come past. It's all right. Hello, girl. What Looks like a young enough fool you've got there. Hello, big girl. You are beautiful. See? Behaving nicely. There you go. Beautiful eye. I love moments like that. You can hear the rasping as they move through the bushes. That is such a special moment. I'm just going to wait for her to move a little bit further away before I reposition. She is keeping an eye on us. It's okay, girl. It's all right. You're not going to do anything. All right, girl. A little bit unsettled by the sound of the paraglider in the air. You can see that in the head swing, in the her body posture, that swaying from side to side, moving her head around. That just was a very clear indication that not that she was feeling aggressive, but that she was feeling a little bit unsettled all of a sudden. And very often with things buzzing in the air, whether it be a helicopter or the paraglider that we can hear or microlite, elephants get that little bit unsettled with it. It stresses them out a little bit, which is why I was just sitting waiting for her to move on past us. But when they walk that close, that you can look into their eyes. It is the most incredible feeling. She's far enough now that we can go and reposition. We'll turn around further up the road. And we'll look back towards her. This morning just keeps getting better and better. I was talking about, before I got distracted by her walking past, I was actually talking about the tuskless elephants and the fact that we had a tuskless male walk past us. So I chatted a bit about the fact that it is a naturally occurring phenomenon. This, by the way, is the entrance to the hyena den that I've just used as a U-turn spot. So I think it's safe to say the cubs will be hiding away from the elephants that have just moved through. So about 4% in a natural population. In certain areas within Africa, the poaching problem has actually led to a tremendous increase in the occurrence of that gene. It's boosted it up from 4% to about 34 to 40% in certain areas in Africa. And that's because obviously the elephants with the biggest tusks get poached, whilst those without tusks do not. That's not something that occurs here within this particular part of, well, within South Africa in general. We don't tend to have a problem with poaching of elephants. The incidents are very, very few and far between. So that tuskless elephant is just a naturally occurring genetic variant. Now, the thing about following behind elephants when they're walking away from you is they tend to get a little bit unsettled. Look, that little one's already running off. It's realized that it's been left behind. So we'll wait for them to move slightly off the road, and then we will loop around them rather than try and travel behind them. What happens if you do that is they just keep moving ahead of you. This is incredible stuff. I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel. Tingana has chased an unknown male leopard from Bithylshoek straight into the property even north of that to the Manyaleti, and is now calling and scent marking. Brent is racing back because Tingana is coming back south towards us. So phenomenal stuff happening with our leopard dynamics. Tingana showing his dominance as the male of this area. Now, Thomas said that in his experience, the most aggressive elephant cows that he's encountered have been either tuskless or with broken tusks. Tuskless, Tom, I haven't experienced that much at Juma. I have had a very large female without tusks loom over me once, just to come and keep an eye on me and make sure that I was behaving myself. But she wasn't showing any untoward sign of aggression. She was just letting me know. There are a lot of theories that females with broken tusks, there's a correlation between aggressive females and females with broken tusks, because they've broken their tusks in some kind of way, and that might be from aggressively clashing with different elephants. It's quite possibly true. I personally have known quite a few elephants in my time with broken tusks that I haven't found to be unduly aggressive at all. For example, the matriarch of a herd that I used to follow regularly, Queenie, this is not in Juma, this was elsewhere, she was totally perfectly relaxed, but one day her right tusk just cracked and broke and fell off. So some broken tusks are caused by cracks or fault lines within the tusk itself, just like some people get cracked teeth or teeth with abscesses. Tom, not discounting your experience at all, it is entirely possible that there is a connection between broken tusked females. And we're, of course, open to the Kruger, so we get elephants coming in from there all of the time. What I will say is that the elephants have... Oh, never mind. Tinkana's come back to us again.
So, amazingly, he crossed into Buffalo's Hook. He's now backy. Aubrey says he just chased another male leopard. So he's definitely out on the move, keeping all these interlopers out of his territory. So a busy, busy boy, Mr. Tinkana is at the moment, trying to keep all these ridiculous young males who are moving in and out of his territory. Okay. He's just gone behind the bush.
Okay.
Let's go forward a little bit. Where's he gone? Oh, there he is. So, a good morning to Aaron from the land of the long white cloud. Aaron says, well, if Karula's the queen, does this make Tinkana the king? For the moment, yes, he is definitely the dominant male leopard on Juma. And he's having a bit of a tough time of it at the moment. It seems to be quite a few young males that he's got to see off. Now he's heading west again. So there is a very strong chance he's going to cross our boundary, but we will stick with him for as long as possible.
Okay, come and take three.
He's going back into that very difficult area where we lost him a little bit earlier, but we will try stay with him. Hopefully he chooses a nice elephant path that we can follow him through. So nice to follow him through here, and I think we'll get a nice view. There's a nice big elephant path that I intend to follow as much as possible. And of course not ideal, but better than just going willy-nilly through the bush. And he's doing the same.
Looks like he's going to join up with this nice big elephant path. So he's walking straight down this big elephant path that we're going to try to stick on. And Siberia, one of our zoomies, is wondering if I've ever seen a leopard go fishing. I actually have. I've seen them catch quite a few catfish in different parts of Africa. And it is a funny thing to see because they often get completely covered in mud while they do that. Oh, Impala, I've spotted him again. And tail is up. I'm going to try to get you a view of that in a second. Now, the elephants have made this area a little bit difficult by pushing over lots of trees. Unfortunately, he is heading into a slightly more open area now. You can hear the impala off to the left. So Nora is wondering, does his territory also cover Arethusa? It does. He does go into Arethusa. He used to actually sort of be the dominant male over the whole of Arethusa. But now, with Anderson coming and him taking over quite a lot of Mvula's territory, he's no longer dominant over the majority of Arethusa. That is Mr. Anderson. But he has extended, he's actually increased his territory size quite exponentially to the north, and that's where we are. Okay, I'm just going to try to loop around him and where it's a little bit less thick. Maybe it's not a little bit less thick. We should be getting a nice view of him shortly. He's going to go up to the beautiful open patch. These elephants are really giving us... Oh, let's just watch those GoPros. There we go. We put ourselves at risk to save the GoPro. Sorry, guys, I do need to be on the Game Drive channel for a second to try to get Ephraim in here. FF. What's your position?
Yeah, I'm on a waiting spot for you now. Here you're going to check in.
Yeah, I think best place is going to be on Vertel Access. We're probably about 70, 80 meters from it now.
Copy.
There we go. Look at that. Using that big elephant path we're talking about. Love it when they do that. Oh, it's buttered popcorn. If he's going to come out at that big Scotia on Wheelchair Access, towards those mud wallows.
You know.
Any other stations interested in this position, I recommend if you are coming to come quite sharply. I think he will cross through to see Bambili. Oh, so much fun following leopards, and especially someone as active as this guy. And he is out patrolling, keeping all the young pretenders to his throne at bay. So he's been kept very busy by young male leopards in the last couple of days, and he has been walking an incredible distance.
So not only does he have to keep the young pretenders at bay, his old nemesis, Mr. Mvula, has actually been seen quite frequently in this area. Unfortunately, just outside of our traverse zone, but he's around as well. But I think.
There
we go. Morning, everyone. Ah, thank you. Apparently, I forgot to switch off my lights once we got going this morning. That's the one thing about heading out in the pitch abject blackness of the dawn. So Steph on YouTube is saying that she's short. Tingana's thinking, meh. It's all in a morning's work, you know, keeping these young pretending males at bay. Smelt. Haven't he smelt something that's piqued his interest? Not that much though, and he's off on the move again. Oh, he's found something smelly. To Roland, let me just try and get you guys in there quickly. Whoop. There we go. Busy morning. Us on our toes. Oh, he's coming back towards us. Why, thank you. Sorry, F. Bezold. Oh, he's actually got a kill. So that F says he's just seen a kill here. So what's probably happened is he's made a kill, and then he heard that other male leopard that he went off to chase. He's moving the kill. I can't see what it is yet. I think we're probably going to have to move around to the other side. We'll just have a quick look from here. And so I think he made that kill. Remember when we first found him this morning, he had all that sort of blood and sort of stomach content on his face. And I thought he might have lost the kill. But I think he made the kill, abandoned the kill, to go sort out one of these young pretenders that was coming into his area, and now has returned to feast. So we're just gonna jump around to the other side of F from there so we can actually see what he's feeding on as well. Can't see what it is just yet. Now, I wonder if it's one of those baby warthogs we see quite regularly in this area. I don't think so, I can't see. We will find out in a few short seconds. I think it's mommy warthog. He's got a mommy warthog. Right, let me just go forward another few meters so we can see a little bit better. So when Dave?
Yep, that's good.
So it looks like he's caught the female warthog we've seen in this area regularly with the babies. That's definitely an adult female. And we actually got asked last night about Tingana's preference in foods, and he does seem to have a preference for warthog and aardvark, so the burrowing animals. And we have seen him live go completely underground to pull a warthog out of a burrow. This is excellent news. he has eaten a fair whack of it already. And hopefully he is going to hoist this one, unlike the last kill we had with him. And again, he's in the perfect position to hoist, even though he didn't last time. There's a beautiful big Scotia, the exact same species that he was next to last time, up above on that termite mound. So hopefully he does take that out of the tree. Listen to that noise, listen to that crunching. Just hear him feeding. Look at those, they're called regal blowflies, those big blue flies buzzing around him. And they're busy laying their eggs in that carcass. So he'll have no problem eating the maggots when they're set in. And in this heat that we're having at the moment, there's probably already a, well, not yet, but by the end of today, some of them would have hatched. So a huge welcome to Ethan, who's joining us for the first time. And Ethan is saying, what's going on here? How does this work? Are these two people in Jeeps? Well, we're on Game Drive, open Game Drive vehicles, Ethan, and we are live in the African bush. And at the moment, we are with the dominant male leopard in our area, and he's killed what looks to be a female warthog. And he's busy chowing down, so to speak, on it. And so Ethan, twice a day, we go out in our Game Drive vehicles and try to bring you the wonders of Africa live to wherever you are in the world. So, here we go. And at the moment, we are looking at a leopard, and we are on an incredibly great leopard streak at the moment. We've had leopard every day for the last 8 days. And it has been absolutely spectacular. So, welcome to Safari Live, Ethan. So Heidi's wondering how he made his way back to this carcass after leaving it. Is it, do they have a road map in their heads, or is it just scent? I would say it's probably mostly scent, Heidi. And of course a leopard can remember where his boundaries are, so I would think there is some sort of road map and he would realize where it is. But I think once they get into the general area, their nose takes over and they follow that to the carcass. There we go, he's opened that up using his pre-molars and molars as a big cutting tool to cut open the skin. And now you'll see him as he gets in there. There we go, he's still cutting, but he uses his incisors between the canines to grip and rip meat off. There we go, nice big chunk there. And then when he turns his teeth there, he's just cutting off a bit of sinew by the looks of things. So one wolf in South Carolina is asking us a question for the first time. So we do encourage that one wolf, keep asking questions. And he'd like to know if Tingana came across Quarantine or Kunyuma, who are two young male leopards, would he chase them as well? Most definitely, he wouldn't want them in his area. He's not related to them, so he would have very little tolerance. And if he managed to get hold of one of them, he would try kill them. So Justin has got a very interesting point. He says, is it not possible that the leopard Tingana was chasing could have made this kill and he's stolen it? It is very possible, although in this particular circumstance, I think it's unlikely, and that's just from the tracks we were following. So I'm pretty sure he's made this kill and then possibly heard that other leopard calling to the north, and that's what set him off on his march. So from the tracks, pretty confident that he made this kill and has then moved off to chase the other leopard. But in normal circumstances, Justin, it is a very, very strong possibility. Male leopards are not adverse to scavenging off other leopards if opportunity arises. Oh, look at that, Dave, do you see it? Just come, oh, he flew out. It was a little yellow pansy butterfly that actually landed on the carcass for a second. Attracted to the moisture, no doubt. And you can see, like he did with that impala carcass, how he's put it into a thicket there. There's going to be no visual for the vultures to see from the top. But I think it is going to start honking in terms of smell. So he might want to put it in the tree, otherwise the hyenas might use their nose to find him. You can see how that camouflage works when we pull out a little bit. If you come out a little bit more, Dave, look at that. He almost disappears, and he's no more than probably about 10 feet from us. And just pick up that movement so that those rosettes break up the outline and help him to disappear, so to speak. So Ramey is wondering, how did Tingana know there was another leopard in the area? That's a couple of different ways. He either heard him calling, which is probably unlikely. I don't know how old the leopard was that he chased her. Unfortunately, that all happened north of our traverse area. But I think more than likely he smelt him. Or he could have heard impala alarm calling and or kudu alarm calling and gone to investigate. Well, Tingana is getting his bacon this morning. Now, it is he probably definitely made this kill in the early morning because it is a warthog. or maybe not. Actually, I might be wrong. I'm just trying to have a look and get my binoculars out and see some of the other parts of that carcass to see how old, I think, or how long they've been open and exposed to air for. I think he might have actually got this warthog out of its burrow. Now, he is well known for going underground to grab particularly warthogs and aardvarks. I think he's actually removed this warthog from underground. There are quite a few warthog burrows close to here. Now, warthogs use abandoned aardvark burrows. So normally you would think that this kill was made during the daylight hours because the warthog are safely in their burrows at night. But if I look at that section of the carcass there and how dark and congealed the blood is, I think it's been out in the open for quite a while. I think he possibly made this kill during the night. And if he killed a warthog during the night, he would have had to remove it from its burrow. They only come out during the day, in the daylight hours. So I think he's actually grabbed it out of a hole. So Clayton's wondering, would wild dogs challenge a leopard for its kill? Clayton, if a pack of wild dogs came through here, Mr. Tingana would beeline for the closest tree and the wild dogs would definitely take the kill. They're not normal scavengers, but if there is a free meal about and they are able to take it, they will. I've seen them do it before, but it is very unusual behavior for wild dogs. Look at those flies. Morning, Megan. Megan would like to know, will a leopard eat the entire carcass or their parts that they'll leave? So on an animal like this, Megan, there will be parts that he is unable to eat. So a warthog has some very thick bones, so probably a lot of the spine and the vertebrae you won't be able to break open. The skull he definitely won't, so he will leave that. But all the flesh he will probably try to eat, and as well as the internal organs. It's getting quite warm already. Now, from a leopard's point of view, he's sitting pretty. He's got meat. Oh, he's going to move the carcass. Look at those flies. No, silly, there's a branch in the way. Yes, no, that's not showing that you're a very clever leopard, my friend. But he's big, so brute power is what he will use. Brute strength. This is quite amusing. Yes, no one ever accused royalty of being smart. So he is definitely the king of Juma, although not using his brain at the moment. And to see if he works it out. Now all he has to do is grab the bottom part and pull from that side and he'll succeed. Oh, there we go. Are we going to use our head now? Bravo, or maybe not just yet. No, it's in the same place. defeated by a forked stick, Mr. Tingana. Deanna's wondering how far did he move to chase that other male. Not too far, Deanna. Probably about a kilometre or so. And that other male went scampering off into the Manuletti. So I'm sure he's feeling very chuffed with himself at the moment. Hear that buzz of the flies. Just this constant. The regal blowfly. There's the majority of those. They're actually quite pretty as flies go. They've got their royal blue in colour with an obvious red face. Maybe we will get a closer look at one. Welcome to Harvick, who's a brand spanking new viewer and would like to know what is a Tingana. That in screen at the moment eating the warthog is a Tingana. He is a male leopard. He is the dominant male leopard we see on the live safari drives, and we have been spending quite a bit of time with him recently. And so a Tingana is his name. It means the shy one in Shangan, which is the local language around here. And when he first moved into the area, he was very nervous and scared of cars. As you can see, he no longer is, but that his name stuck from when he first arrived. So as I was saying a little bit earlier, he's sitting pretty at the moment. He's got quite a nice bunch of meat left. And if we come out, you can see he's got a perfect tree if hyenas happen to come around to hoist it into. And then he's got the bar right next door as well. So he's got a lovely pan right there to drink. So he's literally in leopard heaven at the moment. Meat, water, shade, tree. Great. So Lenny said he knows it looks like it's effortless for a leopard to hoist a kill, but it must obviously take some considerable energy since we often find them feeding on the ground. Well, yes and no, Lenny. The main reason we find them feeding on the ground is quite often it's quite difficult or uncomfortable for them to feed in the tree. So even when they hoist, Sometimes they will hoist a kilt, and then when they want to feed, they'll bring it back down to ground, like Karula did on last night's sunset safari. Now, the thing about Mr. Tingana is he'll probably back himself to defend this carcass against one hyena. So only when multiple hyenas come through will he probably move off. Lions, of course, if even a lioness came in here, he would abandon that carcass without too much of, without any of a fight, but it's less likely. So I think one of the main reasons, being such a big male, is he will feed on the ground because he sort of does back himself. I have seen him give the hyena a clip around the ears before, but after chasing, if a single hyena comes in here, he manages to see it off, what he will do is probably then hoist the carcass. Now, with a big warthog, this does look like quite a big warthog. Let's just go to its head quickly there. I want to try and see if it's a male or a female. And if it's a male warthog, I have to tip my hat. And that's why he's a bit stiff. Now, a male warthog is bigger than him. It's very difficult to see from this angle. I can't see all the warts. But if it is a male warthog, which I'm thinking it might be, just judging from the head, male warthog is a good 90 to 100 kilograms, so over 200 pounds. And he's just below that. So, and they're incredibly powerful animals, they're very strong. If this is a male warthog, this is seriously impressive. I'm just gonna move a little bit, see if we can see whether it's a male warthog. We're just trying to see. I'm just going to see if we can get a spot on his face. And it looks. You got the. I must have got forward a bit, Dave.
You would have a look here.
So we're just trying to see if it's a male or female warthog. I think it's a male. I can. Just the way the head is lying is going to make it quite difficult. But let's go back to look at the leopard. Now, this is quite an interesting new viewer we have here, just from the name. So a huge Safari Live welcome to Ginger Fuzzy Kitty. And Ginger Fuzzy Kitty says, aren't we in danger being this close to this big male leopard? How's that, Dave? Let's just change the angle a bit. How's that? There we go. So, as you can see, he's more interested in eating and trying to keep the flies off him than he is in us. So, we are in no danger. And that's not to say that these incredibly powerful animals cannot be dangerous. But, fortunately, I spent a lot of time with them and reading body language and animal behavior is pretty much what we do out here. So he's showing no signs of aggression towards us. He's actually showing no sign of interest in us at all. And he will, if he started showing certain signs of aggression or upsetness, we'd move further away, or we might even just leave him alone. But Ginger Fuzzy Kitty says she can't even get near her cats sometimes. Now, cats are difficult creatures. Fortunately for me, I definitely think I can read wild cats better than domestic cats. Almost looks like he wants to move it. He's not sure yet. So while we sit here and Tingana decides whether he's going to move the carcass or not, Jamie's got some great grey beasts to show you with a little pink around the ear. Oh, so you're still with us? Sorry about that. He did seem like he might move then, so we're still here. And it does look like he's sort of deciding what to do. Or is he just trying to find a new spot to feed in? Oh, look at that. Got a nice big chunk of meat there. I'm still thinking he might move it, so should I wait another 20 seconds or 30 seconds to see what he does? Just move slightly forward for you there, Dave. Starting to feed on the neck. Now, warthog is quite an interesting species. You can actually see the subcutaneous fat layer. And you'll see in different parts, a very thick white section is fat. Okay, I think he's just gonna carry on feeding in this position. It doesn't look like he's gonna move the carcass. So, as I said, Jamie's got a big grey beast who's got a very large subcutaneous fat layer. So let's go see which one it is.
I'm not going to distract you for too long from Tingana, but I just wanted to show you something, a relatively unusual sight at Buffalo's Hook Dam. There is a female hippo here. And the reason that I know it is female is that there is also a rather tiny baby alongside with her. Resting its head on Mom's back. There you can see its little ears. Since it probably can't stand in this particular part of the dam, it's not quite tall enough, standing on its back legs, resting its head on Mom's back. This is the first time I've seen a baby hippo at Buffalo's Hook Dam. Here comes Mom. You can see how tiny that little one is in comparison. Shame, little one. Your first trip to, as far as we know, into Buffalo's Hook Dam itself. Hard to tell exactly how large this youngster is. I would guess at a couple of, maybe a month or two. I wonder where they've come from. Obviously strayed quite far in their feeding last night and decided to settle down in Buffalo's Hook Dam. Not the hippo's favorite place, because it's not quite deep enough for an adult hippo to submerge completely, which means that they sit with their back in the sun for most of the day. It's not an ideal spot. Nevertheless, that's obviously where she has chosen to spend the day. Just an update on the number of elephants that I've just seen. I've had about three herds run past me to the south from the property to the north of us, and I'm sure it's the noise from the paraglider that's unsettled them like that. And I also had a very, very large elephant bull around Buffalo's Hook Dam, and I'm pretty sure that it's a Kruger elephant. It was a huge bull, but he was strolling away from us at 100 meters away. It's interesting how we are getting more and more of these elephants coming from the eastern side of our boundary, so on the western edge of Kruger, where there's hardly any road networks. So the elephants that inhabit those areas hardly ever see vehicles and aren't that familiar with vehicles, particularly open vehicles like ours. And I think that's where he's come from. He decided to move off. Our little baby's ducked beneath the surface of the dam. Oh, there we go, up again. Spraying out a little bit of water that's collected in her nostrils. You can see her trying to submerge as much as possible to cool down. Hippo have exceptionally heat and sun-sensitive skin. That is why they are the aquatic-dependent mammals that they are. Even though they come out at night to feed and walk around during the day, they prefer not to be in the heat of the summer sun. And the sun is still very, very strong, even this late into summer and at this early time in the morning. It's one of the reasons why there was that old myth that hippos sweat blood. They don't, but they sweat a red, oily substance that acts as a sunblock. It's actually something that scientists are looking into using, the chemical base or the chemical makeup of that sweat, as a potential substitute for sunblock for human beings. It's also an incredibly good antiseptic that cleans out all of the wounds and those sorts of issues. So she's lying with her head under the water, and she'll probably could be under the water for between 5 to 6 minutes. And welcome again to our new viewer, Ginger Fuzzy Kitty, who wanted to know, how do the babies only stay with their mothers? Are they not cared for by their fathers as well? And the answer is no. The fathers play no major role in the life of a baby hippopotamus. He will, if the mother decides to stay within the pod itself, within the group of hippos in the dam that the father is the dominant male of, he will protect the whole pod by potentially charging threats. But beyond that, he doesn't play a role in a baby hippo's life. And in fact, most baby hippo, quite a high percentage of baby hippo mortalities are caused by males fighting and very often attacking the youngsters as a sort of misplaced aggression. Particularly in drought situations like the one that we're in, male hippos get incredibly aggressive as space becomes more and more limited, and very often the babies are the first to suffer. So no, it's up to the cow to do all of the baby rearing work. Luckily, she is a very, very large creature, and so there's not much that is a threat to a baby hippo. Anything that would attempt to take on a female like this would be somewhat foolish. Occasionally, lions do get hold of them. That does sometimes happen. And unfortunately, with the current drought situation, hippos have reached a much more weakened state across the board. Luckily, we've had a little bit of rain, so the grass right at the end of its growth season has sprouted up, and the hippos have had a chance to bulk up before we go into our dry season. I suspect we've seen the last rain that we're going to see for a long time, so a lot of the hippos are going to really, truly struggle their way through the next few months. And once that's when a mother starts to become quite weak and is unable to defend her calf. But for now, we've got lovely sightings such as this to enjoy. I'm going to carry on, see what else I can find. In the meantime, back to Tingana.
So we're still sitting here with this male leopard, and he's making short work of this warthog carcass. Oh, he's moving it. He finally managed to get around that stick. Just move forward a skosh. Say when, Dave.
That's good, Brent.
There we go. So I'm hoping he does take it up a tree. Oh, he's eaten a fair whack of it already. There's still quite a bit of meat left. He's positioning himself slightly awkwardly for us. And let's just see if we roll forward a bit, we might get a better view. Don't think so though, I'm afraid. I think we might have to make our way around to the other side of him. Thank you. see if we can have a, find a window through this thicket. Oh, I think that's probably the best. It's not great. You got it, Dave? It's in quite an awkward spot at the moment. Now, James Richard is saying, he says it seems like a lot of books and documentaries portray leopards as far more arboreal than they actually are. Well, they are very arboreal, but it's very interesting. The behavior depends on the individual and on the area they're in. So, leopards in an area where they don't have a lot of hyena pressure will actually, and lion pressure will not even put the kill in the tree that much while the feet are foot on the ground. Of course, here they do hoist quite a lot due to the large population of other predators that abound in the Sabi Sands. But even a massive male like this would have probably struggled to lift a full warthog into a tree. And you will find a lot of the leopards will start feeding on these animals on the ground. And once they've sort of lightened the load, so to speak, they'll take them up into the tree. So unfortunately not the best view at the moment from where we are. Well, Errol, who's a recent Safari Live addict, says he's playing tug of war. Maybe he thinks the flies are on the other end. I think what's happening is as the sun gets higher, he's moving it slowly and slowly as the sun creeps in from this eastern side of the bush. He's trying to drag the carcass towards the west where he's going to have a bit more shade. So, a big Safari Live welcome to Brian, who's another new viewer. And Brian would like to know, do all the animals not react to being watched so closely and for so long? Brian, each individual animal is different, but most of them are very relaxed around our presence. But we have been spending some time with an unrelaxed male leopard that we have been slowly habituating. And in a couple of days, he showed marked improvement and let us get quite close to him towards the end. But it is a process, and it's a respect thing. And the animals will tell you if you're too close, their body language and their general demeanor. So if you are too close, move away and just give them their space. And if you do that correctly, then I can't see, we never have any problems with these animals. So while we don't have the best view of this leopard in the thicket there, we will try reposition shortly. But just to let everyone and remind everyone, so we don't have any confusion, we will be changing safari times tomorrow. The sunrise safari will be going out half an hour later. So we'll be going live from 0600 Central African time, ending at 0900 Central African time. And if you're in the eastern part of the States, we'll be going live from 12 midnight till 3 a.m. And if you're in the west, we'll be going live from 9 p.m. to 12 midnight. That is the Sunrise Safari. The Sunset Safari will be going out at 15:30 Central African time, ending at 18:30. And if you are in the eastern part of North America, it'll be going live at 9:30 a.m., ending at 12:30 p.m. And if you're in the west, on Pacific Standard Time, you will be going out at 06:30 a.m., ending at 09:30 a.m. We're just gonna try and maneuver again. We've got a better view from there, Dave. How's that? Here we go. Morning. Baie goed, dank jouself. Ek weet nie. Ons het hem gevind, is dit nou. Ja, big one. So, there we go. We can see he's making short work of this warthog. He almost seems to be feeding in quite a hurry today. And he was quite hungry when we saw him last night. As we know, Tingane is quite a specialist when it comes to warthogs. He actually goes underground to remove them from their burrows. Eileen is wondering if there's ever been a record of male leopard litter mates forming coalitions like lions and defending a territory together. I'm afraid not, Eileen. They definitely go their separate ways. So guys, we've had such a long, wonderful sighting with him. There are some other vehicles who would like to come in, so we're gonna let them do that. And we'll definitely come back to check on the Sunset Safari, what he's up to, and maybe he will have put it in a tree.
Aubrey.
Aubrey, you're more than welcome to make your way straight in. I'll make space for you. So, guys, we're going to leave Tingane and let Orbs, who helped us find him this morning, come in. And we will be back definitely on the Sunset Safari, but let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Liam's just had a genius idea on the subject of Tingane. Can't believe I was so slow in thinking of it. We are on the road that Tingane walked down last night with Brent on the Sunset Safari. And I have Viam's trusty calipers. And we're going to see if we can't figure out exactly what the size difference is between a bulla's foot and Tingane's foot. I'm just trying to find a nice clear example of the tracks because he walked down this road with a vehicle behind him. So most of the nice ones have been driven over. And I think our best solution might be towards the drainage line where he veered off the road a little bit. So that's been my plan for the last part of the Sunrise Safari. And it's nice because we know specifically that these tracks were made by Tingane. Here we go. Here's some nice clear, I say nice ones, they're clearish ones. You'll have to trust me in the answers that I give you. I'm just going to pull over to the side of the road here. We've got a tree.
Yeah, a big tree.
We've got a big tree. It's very much interfering with my plans. Okay. Can you sort of see them from there, Vian? Cool. All right. Everybody get your pens and your paper out. Let me just quickly measure before we come to the end of our sunrise safari. Okay. This is his right side. This is his left side. I'm going to try to do this without putting myself in his track or in the light that's illuminating his tracks. Let's do left first. It's going to be easiest for you to see. This is his left front, much bigger, much rounder than his back. And it is, dum-da-dum, drum roll, please. Interesting. 10.3 for his left front. His hind is, that's very interesting. His hind foot is 11.3. How interesting is that? Check that again. Nope, that's definitely true. 10.3 and 11.3 for the back track. Now if we go across to his right foot, oh, this one's a bit tricky to see. It's degraded a little bit. There's the back, there's the top. That is fascinating. It must be the way that his weight has fallen. It has to be, because this front track on his right foot is 11.7. So very close to the size of Mvula's right front foot. And his back foot on his right side is 11.1. Probably closer to 11. That's very interesting. What a curious state of affairs. I wonder if it's not somehow the way that his weight has fallen. That also makes sense, that if you've got a bit of a slope in terms of measuring tracks, that it plays a difference. I cannot believe there's such a difference in length between his back left foot, which is much, much longer than his front left foot. But there you go. We're adding to our data all the time. I hope you've all recorded those measurements. And we have to keep doing this in different soil substrates as well, because different sand makes different tracks look bigger. It's interesting. That's not what I was expecting at all, William. Mvula. Mvula's front right track is bigger than all of Tingana's tracks, I think. Yes. Mvula's front right was 11.8. The biggest track that we got here, what did I say, was 11.7, Tingana's front right. Now there you go. I'm gonna keep this project going, and we're gonna measure track sizes in different soil substrates, because that's gonna play a huge role in the size of the tracks.
Work out the average.
Work out the average, yeah. Interesting. So there's another interesting measurement. Tingana's back left was 11.4, bigger than his front left, which is, to me, quite interesting. We know that the back tracks are slightly narrower, but that's very interesting that it went in that sort of direction, whereas Mvula's back left track was 10.4, so much, much smaller. I think the soil substrate and any kind of gradient on the side of the road plays a role in whether or not they go, the tracks are slightly bigger or slightly smaller. The more weight they put on the track, the larger the track's gonna be. This is a fun project, I'm enjoying it. Might disappear slightly through this dip. Let's just try and get through to the other side. Might be okay. tracks on that path. Side, we're drawing to the last sunrise safari. Brent's still carrying on with his incredible cat streak that he's had over the last few drives. He's going to be very, very happy about that. And of course, the prospect again at Tingana this afternoon. I must say, I really, really enjoyed every moment of my Gymnogene Harrier Hawk sighting. I've never, ever had such an extraordinary sighting of one of those birds in my time in the bush, and I'm so glad that I was able to share it with all of you, and I'm very much looking forward to seeing the slow motion version, because of course you guys could all watch that, but I can't see exactly how it played out. And we're going to finish off our sunrise safari with a herd of ellies that are, this is the herd that was running away from earlier, so we're going to stop here. And we're just going to let them move slowly off the road. See the behavior of that female at the back. Just a little bit unsettled. Just a quick reminder for all of you that if any of you are confused about time changes, you can go to the blog.wildearth.tv. and get a better idea of exactly when our show will be on, when our safari will be on. Ooh, not happy elephants. This is why I'm keeping such a large distance from them. They hold, their body language is so unsettled. But yes, have a look at the different times, see if you can get some information from there, and hopefully we will catch you again on this afternoon's sunset safari. Just a reminder that those time changes will only take effect tomorrow, so on the 1st of April, and I promise you it's not an April Fool's joke, that we really are just changing the times to start with the beginning of the month. It is tomorrow, isn't it? Today is the 30th. Yes, it is tomorrow.
Because we've got 32 days this month.
We definitely don't have 32 days this month. I'm going to let these ellies slowly move away from me. Give them plenty of space. Shame they've obviously had a very stressful day. That trumpet was probably one of the youngsters being feeling a little bit unsettled and upset. Anyway, we've come to the end of our sunset safari. Viam, thank you for all of your fantastic camera work, as well as to Jandre, who was the cameraman for the first half of the show. I'm going to say goodbye on Brent's behalf as well, and a big thank you to Dave, who was on the back with Brent. An incredible sunrise safari once again. Thank you to the lovely ladies in final control, to Jerry and Lou, who direct and make very difficult choices between different extraordinary sightings. And always our tech team working in the background. Most importantly, thank you to all of our viewers for your questions and your comments. They really make a vast difference to our drives. It makes us feel like we have you on the back with us. Have a wonderful day, and we will see you for the sunset safari. Cheers.